effects due to the agricultural practices or due to the local conditions. And we had left with looking at the effect of changing environment because of the irrigation coming up in that area. At the time when we are collecting the data, the micro environment or the microclimate was different than the climate which has been obtained after the project has come into picture. And we had seen that the through one example that whenever there is a dry condition, whenever there is a condition where you have arid climate, semi-arid climate, and you have the areas, irrigated areas, surrounded by the fallow areas, which are dry areas, so not irrigated areas, then you will have the advection effect. The advection will be experienced, and because of that, you will have the conditions looking at the general wind direction. Now, if you look at the windward side, the starting edge of the windward side of the field will have the clothesline effect, whereas subsequent to that, you will have the oasis effect. In the case of oasis effect, what it means? It means that the conditions have become such that the evapotranspiration has reduced because of the fact that the air mass which has passed over the or which is passing over the irrigated area is becoming cooler and is becoming more humid. So because of that, its capacity to evaporate or its capacity to evapotranspirate will reduce. And therefore, we had also looked at that as a correction. You will find that if your areas are very large, the irrigated areas are very large, the net effect will be that you will have to put a correction factor which is less than 1 because of the enhanced oasis effect. So that will be the end result. That will be the end result in terms of a reduced value of evapotranspiration than what you have observed when the conditions were such that you are using the data on small patches of irrigated areas which were surrounded by or which were followed by the fallow areas or the areas which are not irrigated. So that will make a difference of maybe 5 to 10%, and you can put a correction factor on the crop coefficient. Let's look at some of the other effects which can be taken into consideration. The effect due to the soil water. The level of available moisture, or the level of moisture which is prevalent at a particular time, that will also influence the evapotranspiration activity. And that is what is shown here, that it also depends on what is the condition of the climate. The climatic conditions will also influence. But assuming that the climatic conditions are not very different, then the factor which is influencing, the other factor which is influencing the ET crop will be that what is the type of soil. For example, if we assume that we know the type of soil, because ultimately the moisture holding capacity or the way the moisture is held is a function of the soil characteristics as well. So if we assume that the soil characteristics are known, then we know by now that the moisture depletion or the moisture deficit which is being created up to a particular might be in a position, the root system might be in a position to extract the moisture without any problem. But when the tension increases, then the evapotranspiration activity will also be affected. In general, the ET crop is not affected up to a stage where the atmospheric tension is close to 1 atmosphere. And at that stage, there is a stage for different soil types. For example, in the case of clay, that stage will be attained when you reach a level of 30% of total available water. TAW is total available water. And in the case of loam, this level of 1 atmosphere will approach at a situation where you have extracted around 40% of the total available water. And in the case of sand, up to around 60% of the total available water. So these are the indicators. These are the indicative. You will, at least you can now visualize that how much moisture is available in fact, without influencing the evapotranspiration characteristics or without reducing the evapotranspiration in a particular crop. Let's have a look at this variation on some actual case where the cotton has been used as a crop. So if you plot mean ET cotton and millimeters per day. This mean ET cotton is between the for the period between the irrigations. What is the mean value of evapotranspiration? And on this side, if you plot irrigation interval, let's say that we have the irrigation interval varying from these values and so on, and on this side the scale is something around 1. How the irrigation interval influences the ET crop. In other words, what we are saying is that if you are applying the water more frequently, then what will be the effect on the ET crop than if you will apply the water at a larger interval. So for example, in this particular case, it has been observed that when you are applying the water if the mean ET cotton is 6 millimeters per day, then as long as you are applying the water at a reasonably large interval also, it is not making much effect. Only after, if you go beyond an interval of around 18 days, it is making some impact on the ET crop. Whereas, if this evapotranspiration requirement is much higher, for example, if there's other extreme, you might find that in this particular case, might be having something of this nature. That even if, since the evapotranspiration level is very high, even if you apply the water very frequently, you will find that in general, if you would have applied the water at the desired rate, then the potential evapotranspiration could have been 14. And there's a maximum which it, there's a peak consumptive use rate or the peak evapotranspiration. Whereas because of the fact that you are applying the irrigation at a longer intervals, the evapotranspiration, the actual evapotranspiration has reduced. So you also know by now that the evapotranspiration is directly related with the ultimate yield of the crop. If the crop is not in a position to evaporate or evapotranspire at the desired rate, it will have the impact on the ultimate yield. Okay. So in this situation, your yield will be affected if you are not supplying the moisture at the proper rate. Similarly, in the intermediate situations, you will find a similar effect that the effect might not be as much as in the case of a situation where your evapotranspiration was very high. So, is basically the rate at which the deficit is being created that is going to influence what is the rate at which you must replenish that deficit. So, that is what is depicted in this particular case, and for other cases also, it will be slightly more, but again, there is some impact. Which shows that we are trying to basically bring in some other factors, that when we go in for the designs, we have to ensure that we know these relationships, we know what is the impact of delay in the moisture supply on the crop yield, and those things will have to be incorporated. Those things will have to be looked into for proper management of water. Now, as far as in this particular situation, depending on the actual level of your evapotranspiration, the factor which has to be incorporated will be dependent on what is the actual practice you are adopting, what is the actual irrigation interval which you are taking into consideration, and on that basis you can incorporate the effect or the correction factor on the KC values. Okay, the KC values will also be influenced if your evapotranspiration is not allowed to take place at the desired rate. That is what is happening here in this case. That is very, very essential to understand that if you are supplying the moisture at the rate which is the desired rate, in this case this is the desired rate, then you should have been in a position to get the evapotranspiration at the same rate. But since you are applying the irrigation at higher intervals, in other words, what is happening is that you know this is your the total available moisture, total available water. Out of this, you can only this much can be extracted. This is what can be extracted by the crop system without any reduction in AT crop, isn't it? So if you keep this much moisture in the soil, then the AT crop will occur at the potential rate. If you reduce, now what happens when I supply the moisture at a larger irrigation interval? The irrigation interval means that you are supplying, you are replenishing this deficit which has been created. If 5 days, if I wait for 3 more days, if I make the interval 8 days, then this soil is not having that much capacity to absorb the moisture to be serving the plant for 8 days. And that 8 days limit is on the basis of what is the rate at which the moisture is getting depleted. That is the ET crop, that is dependent on ET crop. So if your ET crop is high, it will mean that you will have to replenish the deficit which is created. The deficit will be created in a relatively smaller period, and unless you replenish that deficit after those many days, you are going to have problems. Your yield is going to be affected. We'll come back to all these concepts later also when we'll go into the scheduling. At this stage, I think this much is sufficient to know that all these are the additional factors. At the same time, let me point out at this stage that these factors which we are discussing, the local factors or the factors which are dependent on the local conditions as well as the agricultural practices, this is not going to influence very drastically the ET crop. The percentage up to which this might be influenced, unless there are some specific, very specialized conditions, you will find that the percentage will be, the order of magnitude will be around 5 to 15%. But at the same time, in some situations, it becomes quite very major factors, and there can be a situation where it can be really detrimental if you are not taking care of these impacts. Let's now go to the groundwater. Groundwater is another condition which will influence the KC values, or you can also say that it will influence the evapotranspiration activity. Why? Because in the case of the groundwater, the level at which the groundwater is available, if this is your ground level and your groundwater is somewhere and this at this level, this is the groundwater level. Now it depends what is the depth, how deep the groundwater is in comparison to the ground level, and it also depends on which crop you are growing, what is the root system, what is the effective root zone. So if the effective root zone is as this much, then in some cases it might not influence the crop. In that case is dependent on the soil type, because how much this groundwater can influence this zone is the function of the capillary characteristics of the soil. So in some cases, if the soil is light soil, the soil is sandy, then the situation is not that bad. In that situation, the capillary zone will be very small, and you might not you might feel that in this particular case, if the groundwater is somewhere here, it might not influence the root zone. Whereas if you have the heavy soil, it will influence the root zone. But in what way it influences the evapotranspiration? There are various items which will, one is that you will have the soil in this area will be, its water content will be higher, it will be wet soil, and that can create problem in terms of the agricultural operations. For example, if you want to use the land preparation, if implications on the soil if it is very wet, the water content is very high. Secondly, you will also find that the wet soils, they don't even under the conditions when the energy is available, they get warm very slowly. So, because of the slow warming, you will find that the delay in germination will be there, because for the germination to take place, the temperature in the soil has to reach a particular level. So there can be delay in the germination. Land preparation is another situation where you are having problem in terms of the groundwater availability. The plant development can also be delayed. These are some of the factors. Then along with this, you will also find that there can be problems due to aeration. If the water is, if the moisture is always available in the soil at the water, groundwater level, the groundwater table is quite close, you will find that the pore spaces will be always filled up with water, and the aeration can be a problem. There are, if you look at the crops, there are many crops which behave differently under these conditions of high groundwater availability, and they have been divided into three different categories. Those crops which have high tolerance towards the groundwater, medium tolerance, and those which are sensitive crops. Now, when the groundwater is at 50 centimeters, these are the crops which are having high tolerance: sugarcane, potatoes, broad beans, and the medium tolerance crops are sugar beet, wheat, barley, oats, peat, cotton. Sensitive crops are maize and tobacco. Similarly, under the waterlogged conditions, the waterlogging condition means that the groundwater is even still higher. Under those conditions, rice, willow, strawberries, grasses, most of the grasses, plants, these are the high tolerance crops, whereas the other extreme is the peaches, cherries, olives, peas, beans. So the characteristics of the crops will have to be looked into when you have these situations where the groundwater is very high, is quite close to the root zone. And as I have told you, that is also going to be a function of which soil you are dealing with. So in this case, here, the minimum depth of groundwater table, there is a general thumb rule which has been suggested here. If you have sandy soils, the rooting system or the root zone depth plus around 20 centimeters is the recommended depth up to which the groundwater should be, groundwater table should be. Beyond that, in the case of loamy soils, plus 40 centimeters. In the case of clay soils, plus 80 centimeters. Now, if you have these conditions prevailing, then in general, you don't have to put any correction factor. Whereas if your conditions are violated, then you'll have to look into the greater depth, which crop you are talking about, how much it will be influenced because of the the close proximity of the groundwater table, and that effect has to be taken into account. Then the next item which we like to look at is salinity. Salinity affects the evapotranspiration activity in many ways. One is that it exerts the higher osmotic pressure. So because of this, the root system will find it very difficult to extract the moisture. In the salts which are available, their osmotic pressure is much higher, and that will create the conditions where the levels which you are discussing, which we are saying that in a particular soil, the level of extraction by the root system, we have defined those levels. Those levels won't be valid anymore if you have the saline conditions. Then it will also affect the physical characteristics of the soil. The structure of the soil can be affected. It will also cause toxicity and affect the growth. This toxic conditions can be harmful to the crop development, and salinity can, from that angle, it can influence the crops. And once the crops are influenced, then you have the influence on the evapotranspiration as well. One way to offset this particular situation is to keep the level of moisture which is available at any time in the soil at a higher level. With the high moisture levels, these effects are reduced. So there's one way of handling that situation. Then there are other ways by reducing the salinity, or by even doing the leaching process. Leaching is the process in which you use a lot of water to flush the salts, which are harmful salts, from the soil to a level much lower than the root zone system or the root zone depth. So you apply a lot of additional water on the surface, and that water dissolves the salts which are the problematic salts. Those salts are taken to a level. In that case, the groundwater table has to be much lower. And in case where you have water logging problems, you cannot do that. But in those areas where the rainfall is quite high, the leaching is automatically done. Whenever you get a lot of rainfall, that is doing the leaching process in a natural manner. But in those situations where the rainfall is not excessive, you might have to use the rainfall, the irrigation water, you have to use the additional irrigation water, and that becomes the additional requirement of irrigation, is known as leaching requirement, which will again, when we look at the total requirement, when we consolidate the requirements of irrigation, we will come to that leaching requirement also. But that is one way of reducing the salinity. But in general, the ETC value or the crop evapotranspiration is not changed unless you are certain that the salinity is creating a problem or is creating some effect on the growth of the plant. So unless the growth is affected, if there is some level of salinity, you might ignore that. There's no correction which is made on the KC value. The correction is required only when the level is such that it affects the growth of the crop. Then water and crop yield. This is another aspect which we have to understand. Then the crop production, the timing and duration of water shortages, we have slightly discussed in the earlier part when we were looking at the soil water availability. This concept was just brought in, that when you are making the water available, at what time you are making the water available and how much you are making that water available, those two things are going to decide what is going to be the crop yield ultimately. There are situations where the deficit which is being created in the soil, the timing of that deficit is also very important, because of the fact that the growth stages of the crop, there are some sensitive growth stages than the other stages which are less sensitive. So if you create a deficit in a stage which is less sensitive, it might not have a very detrimental effect on the ultimate yield than the other situation where the growth stage is very sensitive, and if the deficit or if the conditions are deficit conditions during that stage, if that happens, then you are going to have problem. Then the impact on the ultimate yield is going to be much larger. And that is shown on the using the actual data. Let me plot actual data of this is from non-forage crops, and is between yield as percentage of maximum yield. So that means from 0 to 100%. What is the actual yield as percentage of the maximum yield which can be achieved in that crop? And on this side is the ratio of actual ET crop and the maximum ET crop. The maximum ET crop is that situation where which will be attained when you are supplying the moisture as much as is required. So if you plot this for non-forage crops, it has been plotted some this is the variation. Now this area, this plot is a plot which is showing the mean variation, which suggests that if your actual evapotranspiration reduces, then the yield will also be reduced accordingly. And the yield reduction is, in this particular case, the yield reduction is looking to be proportional, but is not always so. It depends on many other factors. It depends on where those deficits were created in the total growth period of the crop. This dotted portion is showing the variation that in general for different types of deficits. For example, if you had created the deficit in a stage which was very, very sensitive stage, then in that case, you might find that even if you had created a deficit which was not very high deficit, but the impact which it made on the ultimate yield was very high. In this particular case, for example, let's say that if you are somewhere here, now your deficit creation is, the actuality is quite close to the 100% level, but still the amount of yield reduction which it has done, it might be quite large in comparison to the other situation. For example, if you are somewhere here, this is the yield percent as percentage of the maximum, it has reduced by around 50%, whereas if the stage was some other stage, the same thing has been found that there is hardly any impact on the yield. For example, if you are looking at this extreme of the graph, you find that there is hardly any difference in the yield when the same deficit was created in another stage. So this variation, this scatter of this total area which has been shown here, that proves that point, that is not only the deficit, the level of deficit, which is important, but is also important at which stage that deficit was prevailing. Now, similarly for some other crops also, for example in the case of sugarcane, the plot is something of this nature, and the scatter is both the scales are same, and on this side is the ratio of the actuality to maximality, and on this side is the yield as percentage of yield. Maximum yield. Look at this. This particular area belongs to the situation where you have created this deficit in the late growth period, and this side, when the deficit is created in the actual the active period of growth. Now, if you are creating any deficit in this period, which is more sensitive period than the late growth period, then you are getting more for the same level of ET reduction. You are getting much less amount of yield, or the yield reduction is much lower. This area of relationship between the crop ET and the yield reduction is a very vast area, and it has been treated separately in another of your papers, paper number 33. The yield response to water. So that is a very elaborate explanation on all these factors, how this yield reduction is taking place, and what are the various characteristics of the crops on which it is based on. Now, let's come to the other factors, other conditions which can influence the ET crop. And one is the method of irrigation. Which method of irrigation you are using, that will also make some impact on what is the evapotranspiration or what is the influence on Kc value. Then what way this can influence the Kc? Again, the major factor which will influence is the way the moisture is being made available, because these methods, so far we have not discussed what are the various methods of irrigation. We will be very soon discussing those, but in general, to tell you that there are methods which are known as surface irrigation methods. Which use the concept of the gravity flow, and sometimes they are also termed as flooding method. That there can be some change in nomenclature, but what we mean by that flooding is that you are making the water available on one side of the field and it flows under the gravity force to the downstream side of the field. Then there are methods like sprinkler irrigation method, in which you use the sprinklers and the water is sprinkled over the area, in which case it will wet the plants also, whereas in the case of surface irrigation method, those irrigation methods won't wet the foliage of the plant. The canopy won't be touched even. Then you have the drip irrigation method, where in that case you are using the drippers and you are making the area which is providing the moisture to the root system, you are making that area wet, so that the reduction in the moisture requirement can be made. So these are the major methods. Now in all these methods, it has been found that ultimately these methods don't make much difference in terms of the evapotranspiration requirements, unless they are in some case, for example, in the case of surface irrigation methods, since you are wetting the total soil, it's felt that it might be more water consuming method, but is not so, because in the case of sprinkler irrigation, you might be reducing the amount of moisture which has to be supplied onto the area, or you might be in a position to have a better control on the irrigation method, because you can operate the system anytime you feel like. You can operate it for any period of time as desirable, whereas in these methods you cannot do that, because there is a requirement that the water must flow from the upstream end to the downstream end, and that requirement has to be fulfilled so as to provide a uniform depth over the whole length of the field. But in this situation, since we are putting the water from the top, the crops get wet and it enhances the evaporation. The evaporation is much larger. All that water which remains on the leaves, that gets evaporated. So the evaporation losses increase. Then there are some losses which are spray losses, which are because of the wind. The water might go to some other areas where it's not intended to be applied on. So that can be another loss. In terms of the total requirement, that requirement remains almost similar. There can be some saving in the case of drip irrigation method, So from these point of views, the method of irrigation can make some difference, but not very drastic difference. You have to look at the other conditions, other prevailing conditions. If you are looking at the sprinkler irrigation, how much is the wind influencing the irrigation activity? So all those things have to be incorporated, and that is what I think at this stage we can only just mention about those variations because of the irrigation method. Then the cultural practices, these can also influence this plant population, tillage, mulching, and the provision of windbreaks. In the case of fertilizers, it will only influence the evapotranspiration if the salts, the desired salts in the soil are not available. So if in that situation, unless you supply the fertilizer, unless you apply the fertilizer from outside as additional nutrition which is desirable or which is required, it may not have any impact. As if the natural salts are available, then the fertilizer might not have any impact. So you have to look at what was the condition of the soil. With respect to the condition of the soil only, you have to look at these this particular factor. You can also, to a certain extent, consider where these salts are available. Are these available beyond the root zone depth, or they are within the root zone depth? Or is your irrigation method such that is flushing the salts beyond the root zone depth? Or if you have supplied the fertilizer, is it flushing the fertilizer beyond the root zone depth? If that is happening, then that means there is some, is going to affect the evapotranspiration activity. So only from that angle, that since it is affecting the crop growth, it might affect the root zone, the evapotranspiration activity as well. And the plant population is not a very major factor. It will make some difference in terms of the evaporation, because if the plant density is high, then the crop will cover the ground, and only in the beginning, when is the initial stage, you will find that the evaporation will be influenced to a certain extent, but in the later on stage, when the crop coverage is going to be there anyway, that is not going to make that difference also in the evaporation activity. So the evaporation activity is the major activity which is going to be the evaporation from the soil is going to be influenced in this particular situation. The tillage is the process in which you just disturb the topsoil for various reasons. One is the weed control. You want the weed to be removed. The other is to change the soil structure. Because many times the soil gets sealed, the topsoil gets sealed because of the impact of the raindrops, and that sealing process will change the structures. It might seal the pores, and that sealing process will influence the infiltration ultimately. And since the influence of infiltration will be to reduce the moisture getting absorbed into the soil, more of the water which is going over the soil will be going as a waste, as a runoff. Very little amount will be in a position to get into the soil and thereby get absorbed. So from that angle, a tillage can make some difference if there's lost meat around, and going in for the tillage practice, you might be able to influence the weed and thereby reduce the evapotranspiration. Similarly, the mulching, in many situations people feel that through the mulching, what is mulching first of all? Mulching is the process in which you let the crop waste be in the soil and remain there, so that it can influence the things like the raindrop impact can be reduced. You also want in some cases to reduce the evaporation from the soil. But it has been found that ultimately there are some advantages of mulching, but there are at the same time some disadvantages also. So it's not always true that through the mulching you will get the desired effects which you thought you will be getting. For example, the disadvantage, one of the major disadvantages, that it creates the similar problems like the close proximity of groundwater. It will make the soil remain wet most of the time. It will also induce many diseases. Those can be because of the mulching and because of the additional foliage being made available on the top of the soil. So that can be, there can be some impact of mulching. It can be taken into consideration. Windbreaks can also be influencing the ET crop. It has been found that the windbreaks, there's a thumb rule that the height of the windbreak which is being used will be deciding how much will be the influence of the windbreak and the windward direction, up to which extent it can influence, is around 25 times the height of the wind barrier. And that wind barrier can be in the form of trees, or it can be some artificial wind barrier also. But the influence is something of the similar nature, that assuming that if you are providing the wind barrier, what is it doing? The other climate it cannot change. It can only change the wind speed. It can just reduce the wind speed. For example, if this is a barrier and you have the crops here, this is the wind direction. Now, there will be an extent up to which you will have them. You might save this particular area from the wind which was prevailing wind, but the other parameters remain same. So if there are some areas where wind direction or the wind speed is going to make a lot of difference in terms of the evapotranspiration activity, that can be influenced. So with that, we will close this chapter here. We have looked at all the aspects of the evapotranspiration requirements, how we compute those requirements, and what are the various methods, what are their plus points, what are their data requirements, and if there's any question, I can respond. Thank you.